The correct choice here is the Lhermitte-Duclos. I'm pretty sure I just completely butchered that pronunciation, so pardon my French. Let's look at some of the features that make Lhermitte-Duclos the best choices among these five possibilities. First of all, on diffusion weighted sequence, diffusion ADC map, you can see that this expansile region has lots of area of increased diffusivity. So ADC value is high, so bright on ADC. Also, there are area that has a relatively normal diffusivity compared to the adjacent tissue. More importantly, on diffusion weighted sequence, you do not see an area of restricted diffusion. And that's important because if you do see area restricted diffusion in terms of neoplasm, then you should be thinking about something that's hypercellular. On post-contrast sequence, the Lhermitte-Duclos classically do not show any enhancement, or if they do, they tend to show some mild vascular enhancement. And certainly, you should never see a discrete enhancing mass lesion or a enhancing mirror nodule. If you see that, consider something else. Another key feature for Lhermitte-Duclos is that despite the size of lesion or the mass effect, you do see lots of area with preserved cortical striation. So there is a whitened cerebellar fovea with this preserved striated appearance. If you think about it, that would be a very strange appearance for other type of tumor, like with pilocytic astrocytoma or medulloblastoma. They tend to completely take over and efface the cerebellar fovea, and you tend not to see preservation of cortical striation. So if you see lots of preservation of the striation with a large lesion with a mass effect, Lhermitte-Duclos is a pretty good bet. So on board exam, they can also ask you other questions about Lhermitte-Duclos. It's also referred to as dysplastic cerebellar gangliocytoma. It is not clear whether or not this is truly neoplastic or is a hamartoma or malformation. Nonetheless, it's classified currently as a WHO grade 1 neoplasm or tumor. So it is part of the neural manifestation of Cowden syndrome or multiple hamartoma syndrome. Recall that's the Cowden's is the disease that can produce multiple hamartomas growth or multiple skin lesion, multiple GI polyps. Patient would have an increased risk for development of other type of malignancy. So if you see someone with Cowden syndrome with Lhermitte-Duclos, and the combination is referred to as Cowden-Lhermitte-Duclos syndrome or CLD syndrome, CLD. It is a form of neurocutaneous syndrome. But in this case, it is somewhat challenging because it's very reasonable to consider that this could be a low-grade neoplasm, low-grade in the sense that there's no restricted diffusion. Also, you may consider that could this be a cerebellitis? In that case, patients tend to present with acute symptoms. Like in this case of different patient, older patient, teenager, you can see on diffusion weighted sequence on ADC, there's no restricted diffusion or increased diffusivity. In fact, ADC looks completely normal. And on post-contrast sequence, you see no enhancing mass lesion. Perhaps there's a slight increase in vascular enhancement. Otherwise, no significant enhancement. On FLAIR and as well as on T2, you can see this sort of a dysplastic or disorganized appearance of clearly a mass lesion. Yet there is a preservation of a cortical striation, which would be strange for other type of neoplasm. So this would be a very classic appearance for Lhermitte-Duclos. So let's look at some other choices that do not work as well in this case. For choice A, B, C, pilocytic astrocytoma, medulloblastoma, and ependymoma, they are the big three for pediatric posterior fossa tumors. So if you see a pediatric patient with a posterior fossa tumor, think about those three as predominantly your differential diagnosis. So there are some features that makes pilocytic astrocytoma different than ependymoma, then different than medulloblastoma. In general, on board exam, they may ask you the different grading. So as many of you know, medulloblastoma is the most malignant type, is WHO grade 4, whereas pilocytic astrocytoma is benign, that's considered WHO grade 1 tumor. Ependymoma is somewhere in between grade 2 or grade 3 anaplastic ependymoma. You can use their cellularity and their location to help you differentiate between those three. This is a very generalization, so just please keep that in mind. For cellularity, pilocytic astrocytoma is the hypocellular tumor, low cellularity, so watery tumor. Therefore, on CT, they tend to look hypodense, so they are darker on CT. Medulloblastoma, on the other hand, it has a high cellularity or hypercellular tumor, so they tend to be denser on CT, and ependymoma is somewhere in between. By the way, between those three, ependymoma is the one that likes to calcify. So if I see a pediatric posterior fossa tumor with a lot of calcification, I would definitely think about ependymoma as the strong candidate. And the cellularity also translates into what they look like on CT, excuse me, on MRI. So because a pilocytic astrocytoma is a hypocellular tumor, they tend to look bright on T2, and also they have a high diffusion. So there's no restrict diffusion. In fact, there's a facilitated or increased diffusion. On the other hand, medulloblastoma, the hypercellular tumor, they tend to look darker on T2, and they have low diffusivity. So they will present as a lesion with restricted diffusion compared to the adjacent normal tissue. Ependymoma, again, is somewhere in between. Location-wise, pilocytic astrocytoma classically is present as an extraventricular tumor, so outside the fourth ventricle. The classic ependymoma tend to present as an intraventricular lesion and tend to derive from the floor of the fourth ventricle, whereas the classic medulloblastoma tend to derive from the roof of the fourth ventricle, also intraventricular tumor. For pilocytic astrocytoma, because they are outside the fourth ventricle, they tend to present as an eccentric tumor. For ependymoma and classic medulloblastoma, they tend to present as a midline neoplasm. I have an asterisk right here for medulloblastoma because there are multiple subtype of medulloblastoma. The one that tend to present the central one of the group 3 and group 4. The first two, the sonic hedgehog as well as WNT, they tend not to present as a midline. They can, but they tend not to present as a midline tumor, so please keep that in mind. So this is what they look like on CT. For pilocytic astrocytoma, you can see it's a hypodense tumor, watery tumor. Medulloblastoma, on the other hand, tend to look hyperdense compared to adjacent tissue, so it's a hypercellular tumor. On T2, again, pilocytic is very bright on T2, watery tumor, whereas a hypercellular tumor like medulloblastoma tend to look darker on T2. But perhaps the most useful sequence to judge cellularity is diffusion weighted sequence. For pilocytic astrocytoma, hypocellular tumor, they tend to have high diffusivity, whereas a hypercellular tumor like medulloblastoma tend to have restricted diffusion compared to the adjacent tissue. Ependymoma is somewhere in between. This is a location-wise. You see pilocytic astrocytoma in this case is outside the fourth ventricle, so it's eccentric, extraventricular, whereas classic ependymoma is an intraventricular tumor derived from the floor of the fourth ventricle. The classic medulloblastoma is coming from the roof of the fourth ventricle. Again, this is more referring to group 3, group 4 medulloblastoma. And the pilocytic astrocytoma is eccentric, and the classic ependymoma and medulloblastoma tend to be midline. And there are, of course, other parameters that can help you differentiate between those lesions, such as MR perfusion, spectroscopy. And with medulloblastoma, you expect to see hyperperfusion. and also see a more malignant pattern on spectroscopy. For choice E, cerebellar infarction, obviously this is not acute infarction because you don't see restricted diffusion. But if your argument is that this is a subacute infarction or this is a chronic infarction with T2 shine through, then you expect to see infarction at those stage not to have this much mass effect. For chronic infarction, obviously you should see involution or volume loss. So clearly choice E here does not make much sense. So overall, choice D, Lhermitte-Duclos, is the best answer for this case. That's all for pediatric neuro case number 6. Thank you for your attention. Good luck on your board exam.